Lord, I pray for patience to listen to your messages and the perseverance to wait faithfully for your will to be done. Amen. Now let us turn our hearts and minds to worship with our prelude. Goodness, I'm having a time today. Please rise as you are able for our order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our opening hymn this morning is number 660, Lift High the Cross.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. You bring forth our salvation, and by the glory of the cross you transform our lives. Grant that for the sake of the gospel we may turn from the lure of evil, take up our cross, and follow your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the 50th chapter of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn back. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsively Psalm 116, verses 1 through 9. I love the Lord who has heard my voice and listened to my supplication.
For the Lord has given ear to me
whenever I called. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I came to grief and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. Oh Lord, I pray you, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord watches over the innocent. I was brought low, and God saved me. Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt well with you.
For you have rescued my life from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living. A reading from the third chapter of James. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with great strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please rise as you are able to welcome the gospel. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any wish to come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it." For what will it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in glory of his Father and the holy angels. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. When Malcolm and I got married, Pastor Scott Suskovic at Christ Lutheran Church in Charlotte called us quirky. The theme for our wedding reception, you see, was Alice in Wonderland. And I spent a good deal of time explaining to the pastor how this book fit into a Christian setting. After all, Lewis Carroll, the author, was an Anglican priest. And if you scratch beneath the surface of the Alice stories, Christian beliefs and even quotes are evident. A young girl goes down a rabbit hole where there is a queen whose pastime is to condemn almost everyone to beheading. The king follows behind his judgmental, cruel spouse and pardons everyone. Eventually, Pastor Scott caught on, and his homily for our quirky wedding was perfect. Now, one of my favorite conversations from Alice in Wonderland is when the caterpillar, sitting on his mushroom, smoking a hookah, asked the girl, "Who are you?" It reminds me of today's gospel from Mark, where Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do you say I am?" Indeed, who do we say Christ is? Savior? Messiah, Son of God, friend, healer, teacher, confidant, shepherd, leader, counselor, King of kings and Lord of lords. I am sure we can say that Jesus is all of these. At the same time, Jesus is a man for all the seasons in our lives. Peter called Jesus the Messiah, the anointed one of God. The Messiah was expected to become a warrior king like David, with the wisdom of Solomon, the obedience of Abraham, and Moses' compassion for the people. The one prophesied to come long before Jesus walked on the earth. Peter recognized Jesus as the one chosen to restore the people into relationship with God and bring about a new kingdom in the Holy Land. Yet the way Jesus spoke about what would befall him apparently set off Peter. And he rebuked Jesus privately. Now, a rebuke is not merely saying, "You shouldn't have said that," or "You're scaring the children." A rebuke is more like, "Have you lost your mind?" If we are honest with ourselves, we probably would have at least thought the same way as Peter did, even if we didn't say it out loud. But we have the advantage of being on this side of the resurrection. We know the story. Who are you? We humans have different roles in our lives also, don't we? Parent, grandparent, great-grandparent, employee, employer, tinker, tailor, soldier, spy. Yet who are we really? Alice's response to the caterpillar's question is, I hardly know, sir, just at present. At least I know who I was when I got up this morning, but I think I must have been changed several times since then. A very fitting description of our life as a whole, and what Peter and the disciples probably felt when they heard that Jesus would suffer, be denied, be rejected, even unto death. In my inspired imagination, I can see Peter saying, I know who I was this morning, but I've been changed by this conversation. Preconceived ideas of what a Messiah should look like were forever changed by Jesus' own words. Now, words matter. Once upon a time, we were taught that if you couldn't say something kind, don't say anything at all, right? Now, James is correct that the most dangerous weapon we have is our tongues. Nowadays, I would say our fingers also when we type on social media. We live in a society where cursing is acceptable in everyday conversation. Outright lies are repeated constantly by people trying to influence our shopping or our political choices. People have lost the ability to communicate with one another in meaningful ways, without raised voices or threats of harm. Tongues have become even more deadly as our expectation for kindness disintegrates all around us. One of the most abhorrent situations I experienced is when I was in seminary. A seminary professor kept using F-bombs in the class. When I called this person out, I was told that it was a common part of today's language and I need not be triggered by it. I wasn't triggered. I was incensed. I firmly believe that I am able to communicate the good news without resorting to gutter language, and I expect others to also do that. What comes out of our mouths does indeed reflect what is inside us. As James says, we all make mistakes. But we need to be vigilant to accept responsibility and ask forgiveness. Get thee behind me, Satan. Have you ever said that in times of distress or confusion or temptation? I have. The Holy Spirit helps us to recognize the slimy ways of the adversary, whether or not they have been beautifully packaged with kind words and earthly outcomes. Why does Jesus rebuke Peter with these words? Remember the temptations of Christ in the wilderness? Food, the physical needs of food and drink, pride. The Son of God is so important that angels would make sure no harm came to him. power. The devil promised to give Jesus the whole world to rule. Human concerns, dreams, aspirations, and hopes. Whatever Peter said to Jesus, it recalled those times of earthly temptations when human flesh was weak. Get thee behind me, Satan, indeed. Life on earth is hard, and God knows that. Think of all the changes that have taken place in the past century. We've gone from sliced bread to artificial intelligence. Not long ago, I heard that in the digital era, information comes at us so rapidly that our brains cannot physically process it. Sometimes it feels as though we have all gone down to that rabbit hole, to a topsy-turvy land, doesn't it? Yet we have the source of comfort and guidance. The one who is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Following Jesus requires us to bear our crosses no matter what they may be. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, considered by most to be a Christian martyr, was murdered for his position against the Nazi regime. May God grant us the resolve to stay steadfast in our faith, no matter what. Jesus is always with us, on our paths, bearing our crosses alongside us. And we know who he is. Amen.
Please stand as you are able. Our hymn of the day is number 723, Canticle of the Turn.
Thank you.
With the whole church on earth, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Drawn together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray with confidence for the church, God's good creation, and all who are in need.
We pray for the church throughout the world. Form us into communities of forgiveness and grace. Help us to notice where you are calling us into new relationships, and give us courage to embrace the uncomfortable and unfamiliar. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy
is great. We pray for the earth and all its inhabitants. Protect lands at risk of wildfire and heal dying forests. Where fire brings destruction, raise up new growth. Guide us in tending precarious ecosystems. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those who govern nations, tribes, and cities. Open them to the cries of people in need. Direct them in shaping policies that prioritize the health and well-being of all who struggle with hunger and housing insecurity. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for all who are ill, all who are lonely or anxious, and all who grieve. Especially before you today, we name Beverly and Glenn, Richard and Judith, Barbara, Ruby and Cliff, Wayne, Ann, Judy and Bobby, Rachel, John, Sarah and Danny, Carolyn, Susan, Gail, Philip, Ray, Leonard, Tona, Terry, Philip, Sarah, Waylon, Reverend Alan Beverly, Jamie, Sandy and Wesley, Jean and Jim, Virginia, Nicholas, and all those that we say aloud now before you or in our hearts.
Our blessed Bishop Tim, our Pastor Don, and Pastor Cece.
Draw them close to you and soothe them with the promise of your enduring love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for teachers, professors, librarians, school administrators, staff, and all who support the education of young people. Sustain them as they shape learning communities rooted in equity and authenticity. We pray for children of all ages in their learning. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We remember our beloved dead, who with the great cloud of witnesses bear witness to your saving grace. Accompany us in our pilgrimage of faith, that we too place our hope and trust in you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust these and all our prayers to you, Holy God, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace together using American Sign Language or whatever is appropriate for you. Oh, our worship continues with our offering.
Grace seems to take me by the hand.
rise as you are able. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to all to eat, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Thank you. Please rise as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in eternal life.
Amen.
Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is number 810, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
I'm
'tis to grow in faith
by seeking the will of God and sharing his love with all people.
Reminder that there is a council meeting immediately after service. Hallelujah. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.